Hello and welcome for this very interesting webinar that we have today on Wednesday evening. We have a very special guest. I will introduce, you know, the special guest to you in a while. But before that, I'll just give you a quick background of what we do and what is the context of this webinar. I represent PMS AIF World, platform that we had set up 2.5 years ago. The reason, you know, for setting up this platform was our search for good products, you know, for our clients. We were working as a wealth management firm. And we were trying to constantly work and identify what are the good products because we had realized that the returns and the experience that investor gets ultimately depends upon the good product. Now, to identify good product, it requires deep diving of, you know, various products. And that is where we started understanding various structures. Obviously, we knew about mutual fund as a structure, which was an old structure available. And when we deep dive this entire space, we realized and found that portfolio management services and alternative investment fund is a very interesting and very good structure where there are various good products available. But there were less, you know, ways to find out more about these products. And that is how, you know, we thought and we started meeting these fund managers. The more we met these fund managers, the more our conviction started, you know, getting built on this structure. And today, you know, I can tell you we have done more than 140 such interesting discussions. I have done more than 100 in-person meetings. Obviously, you know, before COVID times, I used to travel to Mumbai to do all those discussions. And it has been a very, very knowledge enhancing, you know, time for us. And we have based our business model also purely on knowledge. And that is exactly what we are going to do today when we have, you know, kept this special webinar, where we are going to understand the space of alternates, particularly in the hedge fund category, which is the category 3 of long short funds. Lot of people call this category with different names. Some call it as hedge funds, some call it as absolute return funds, you know, some call it as enhanced return funds category. There are other names like, you know, debt plus category or, you know, equity minus category. So many, many names have been given to this category, and this category has seen, you know, constantly assets growing. Also, it has seen good and bad times, you know, over the last 3-4 years. A lot of good credible companies had launched products, they had to wind up products, they had to, you know, redo their structures. We will understand each and everything, you know, about this industry and this particular category over next 1 hour. We have with us Mr. Amit Saxena, who is the head director, and he presents Daulat Capital Markets Private Limited. And, you know, Amit Saxena particularly we have selected for this discussion because he is the one who has been working particularly in this space since the inception of this space. So he has seen, you know, various companies and various products getting launched and getting, you know, seeing their evolution over time. Before, you know, joining Daulat Capital, he has been working in this industry for more than 16 years. And, you know, during the 16 years, he has worked with Nippon, he has worked with ING and other asset management companies, and particularly in this space. So before taking any further time, you know, having set this context, I would hand it over to, you know, Amit, for him to first tell us in detail about this space of hedge funds or long short funds since its inception. And he has made a very interesting presentation also, where in very brief, you know, he will explain about Daulat Capital, but majority of the slides have been covered on explaining this entire industry and this entire space, from risks, returns, dynamics of this industry to taxation. All questions will be answered. So kindly bear us and be patient for next 1 hour, and after that we will do, you know, questions and answers. Over to you, Amit.
Thanks a lot, sir, for those kind words, and good evening to all of you. Hope everyone is safe in these COVID times. Now, just to take it forward, sir, can you just put up the presentation? I would like to get straight away into. Okay, this is very important. Huh? Because once we are in industry, it is important that views and opinion expressed, whatever we are saying right now, because our whole life revolves around disclaimers, are completely personal in nature. So I'll quickly take you through what Daulat Capital is all about. It's a group which is probably not known to many of us in the industry. It's something which works behind the machinery. It is more than 60 years plus experience in capital market service. The group is basically into B2B segment. So we are market leader in derivative based strategy. We are service provider, or you may call it broker, to all leading mutual funds, all FIIs. We do trim interest volume in the market, probably among the top 10, top 5 brokers in the whole market, cash segment, derivative segment. We are the leading executor of all arbitrage strategies in the market. We are the market makers of all exchange traded funds wherein you guys invest into, be it any fund, we provide the market. And we are the largest executor, one of the biggest setup in India in terms of algorithm-based high-frequency trading. Obviously, all this is supported by state-of-art of technological expertise. And we are also a broking house in the cash segment. In terms of the diversification of business, the business is broadly into B2B segment, and we have now started diversifying it in investment banking and NBFC as well in the last 2-3 years. So proprietary book is the major portion what we take care of, which includes high frequency trading, arbitrage options trading and all. Institutional equity is your broking business, investment banking you understand, and NBFC also you understand. And now this year we have gone into the AIF segment. So this is all about Dolat Capital. I will not take much time on that and come straight away to what we are here for. AIF industry. So yes, interesting. So this industry is possibly, you'll say, the current AIF industry has taken a shape in September 12 onwards when SEBI started AIF regulation. But prior to that, obviously there was a PE industry, there was a VC industry. What SEBI basically wanted is to synchronize everything, make it more structural in nature, being a regulator, because it's always good to have the structures in place and platforms in place. So what they did is that broadly now, if you are managing investors' money, you can either be a mutual fund or you can be a PMS guy or you can be an EIF. And thus all other, so whatever was VC, PE and various kind of funds, and then thereafter have been incorporated into the EIF industry. So the industry basically started from September 12 onwards, 9 years, almost going to be 10 years and sometime now. The industry has already crossed 4.5 lakh crore, which is a significant number. If you look at it in terms of percentage, I think this is the fastest growing industry as compared to mutual fund as well in their inception days. So whether you say PMS industry or mutual fund industry, if you see the first inception, first 10 years, this is the fastest growing industry till date. So whether you like AIF industry, you don't like AIF industry, you understand it or, but you can't ignore it. It's a big industry. More than 759 AIF already registered as on last quarter. So that means you have what, 800 players in 9 to 10 years who are registered as an AIF. So that's a big number. So there are three base categories, right? You have category 1, category 2, category 3. Category 1 fund are broadly close-ended in nature. You have angel funds, venture capital, SME fund, social venture funds, infrastructure fund. To sum it up, basically everything and anything which will have a positive impact on the Indian economy, which is close-ended in nature, which is long-term in nature, whether you are trying to develop a public partnership, whether you're trying to bring up an infrastructure fund, some road infrastructure, some metro project interrate or whatever in nature, which will have a positive impact on the Indian economy, will get a knee sop, and that's why this category has a pass-through status. So this is your Cat 1, and Cat 1 currently is around 44,000 crore. Here comes the hero, which is Category 2. Category 2 is all your VC and all your real estate and private equity funds are coming into Category 2. So PE, structured credit, structured debt funds, all real estate funds, within high IRR, very high credit funds. Some you must have heard those 19% IRR, 20% IRR, 25% IRRs kind of fund. They sit in category 2. It is predominantly unlisted funds, close-ended in nature, has to be compulsorily 3-year close-ended in nature. They cannot take leverage and they also have a pass-through status. So that is your category 2. Our focus today is category 3. Now, what is a category 3? Category 3, SEBI defined category 3 as a complex trading strategies fund. Now, okay, we'll get into that. But category 3 currently is 50,000 crores. It has grown rapidly. If you see between December 16 to 19, a significant growth in category 3. But somehow, if you start seeing from 19 onwards, you'll see this going down. And suddenly, in last year, the category is actually, you know, kind of going down. Why this is going down? This is an upcoming category, and more players are coming into it. There is enormous opportunity in the category, but still the category is going down. So that's something which we will try and cover today, and we'll see how the category has grown and what all are available for our investors and distributors to look into this category. So two, three things very, very important to understand before we get into this is that this category has an option to take leverage up to 2 times. So you invest rupees 1 crore, you can take exposure up to rupees 2 crores, right? So that is one. Second is, again, very, very important. This is a category which is a non-pass-through category. When we say non-pass-through category, means what? Means that the tax has to be paid at the fund level. So post-tax proceed will be passed to investor, but the tax has to be paid at the fund level. I cannot give investor some proceed wherein the investor is subjected to pay tax. So that's the biggest thing in this category. Let's try and get into the category itself. Category 3 started broadly divided into two subcategories. This is prime office, you can say. Category 3 has relative return product and absolute return based product. Now, what are relative return product? What are absolute return based product? How this category is started, we have to first try and understand that. When the regulation came, category 3 was predominantly long short kind of funds. Because category 3, you know, because the taxation was at 35% earlier, when you do leverage and when you get into derivative tradings, right, therein you get that benefit of taking leverage and taking positions which can generate you extra return by taking a lower risk. And that's where the long short fund has started getting into the maximum share of the category 3. But then came the long only fund managers with their long only close ended fund under this category. Now you can always, if you go back to this slide, see that you can launch an open ended and close ended both the product in category 3. Okay, it doesn't have a compulsion that you have to only launch it. So if I will launch a close ended long only equity kind of a product here for a 3-year perspective, this is where the natural progression of all good fund managers. So there are big names who have joined AIF industry, who have started their own AIF, big fund managers, and going doing significantly well today in the industry. And these guys have started their close-ended AIF with their themes. So a theme can be anything, right? They have a high conviction theme. They can do, one can launch a small cap fund, one can launch a mid cap fund, one can launch a thematic fund, like those days when what you used to see in mutual funds. But these are close-ended schemes, right? Why close-ended scheme then? They launch close-ended scheme because they are predominant trust structure. Now if you see the trust taxation, if you are a trust and you are a determinant trust, then basically your taxation becomes effectively passed through. That means what? That you are then eligible for long-term, short-term capital gains. And thus, although it's a non-pass-through, but effective pass-through has been obtained by making it a closed-ended trust structure. I hope I am not complicating it. Let me try simplify it a little bit. If I launch a closed-ended scheme, which is long-only in nature, in category 3 universe, what will happen is that I will get a tax advantage. So short term at 15%, long term at 10%. I will have to return the investor money in 3 years. And because I have already paid tax at the fund level, the investor need not pay tax at their level. Right? Had you invested in a mutual fund equity, the taxation would have been same. Because you would have stayed there for 3 years. You are subjected to a 10% tax, which is a long term capital gain, which is similar here. And we have seen a significant growth in this segment in the category 3 industry, AIF industry, which is your long only segment. What are the advantages? Advantage is that you get a concentrated portfolio, which is, and you get a personalized service, you get a concentrated portfolio, which is suited your particular need, and a long-term investment story. What are the, so to speak, disadvantage? which is not actually disadvantage, it's a market risk. But the risk is that it is relative to market. So if market goes down in 3 years, there are chances that you will generate negative return. So it's just like a mutual fund equity in terms of risk. Now, so this is one category, and of late, we have seen a significant portion of money going into this category from the hedge fund category. So it is all started from long short category, but now a significant portion of the overall inflow in category 3 is getting into the long only segment as well. And there are many established houses and big names who have started their AIFs under the long only segment. But this is not our focus today. Our focus today is the absolute return of the hedge fund category. So let's come to our focus. Absolute return category can thereafter broadly be classified into two categories. One is a long short fund and one is a hedge fund. Now, normally what happens is that we use these names very interchangeably and very frequently, that an absolute return is a long short and it's a hedge fund, right? So broadly, we think all of them are same. If you look into this category, there are two kind of products. This is from a risk return perspective. A market neutral product, and then you have products which are non-market neutral product. So what is a market neutral product? A market neutral product is a product which generally don't take any direction on the market, and it is neutral in nature. So that means what? That means I can take a 2x leverage that is allowed under the regulation. I can take a derivative exposure, right? So whatever is my positive call in the portfolio. So let's say I am long 130, then I have to short 30 to make it 100 net exposure. That's what it means by a market neutral kind of product. So basically your net should be around zero. So that is market neutral. So you are not taking any call on the market. You're trying to play neutral on the market. If you are long something, you are short the equal amount, at least relative value. I'm not getting into delta and beta and all those complicated stuff, but you, broadly speaking, you don't take any direction on the market, and you are not biased towards any direction of the market, whether it is positive or negative. Your net should be around zero, and those are your market neutral products. Within the market neutral products, we will take it one by one, and there are non-market neutral products. Non-market neutral products are the products wherein you take some side on the market. And what are these products? So just to give you a parlance, actually it is not the right correlation, but just to put things in perspective of your traditional investment in mutual fund, you have debt and then you have equity, right? And then you have something in between. So this is your debt and this is your equity, and you have something in between. What is that? That is balance. And then you have MIP, right? So some 75, 35 kind of a portfolio, somewhere some 55, 45 kind of a portfolio, some 65, 30 kind of a variant. And those similar variant are also available under the absolute return category. So you will have, and you if you will go through the product of different manufacturers under this segment, you'll find somebody telling you that I can take a 65% directional call and I will maintain 35% as a long shot or as a market neutral. Or there can be another manager who can say I will maintain 65% as market neutral and only 30% as a directional call. That too helps. Then there will be a different kind of a manager who will say I basically do all as market neutral, but there isn't some satellite strategy to generate alpha. Or there will be a fund manager who will come back to you and say that look, I have a tactical offering. This offering can generate return almost equivalent to equity if everything goes right, while it is not investing into equity. So what are the ranges? The ranges is one has to look at from a risk return perspective. So you have risk which is equivalent to debt, and till the risk which is equivalent to equity. And there are different product offering under the same segment with the same theme, that their theme is to generate absolute return. That's their theme. But they take a different exposure under different product to generate that, and which will have a different risk return matrix. Let's try and see how it works. Which kind of investor will look into what kind of product? So a market neutral kind of a strategy. who want a market neutral product is something similar to who look to invest in debt. Somebody who has a low risk profile, somebody who wants consistency of return, somebody who wants a debt kind of a return. When we say debt returns, it's all relative word, right? We'll say 6% post-tax, 7% post-tax, 5% post-tax. Within that, if you are into my market segment, so you will say, I'm okay with a 3% post-tax. If you are into arbitrage kind of segment, you will say, I'm okay with 386, I'm okay with 4.25. Or you come into short-term income, or maybe, you know, going to the duration, and if you have a credit fund, then you have a different risk profile, right? Similarly, but broadly speaking, a market neutral kind of a product is suited more towards those investors, broadly speaking, who have a lower risk profile, who want consistency of return, and who want return which are almost aligned towards the short-term debt kind of a portfolio. Okay, so there you are not seeking money for 3 years, 5 years investment horizon, just like your duration fund, unlike your gilt fund, right? So you are seeking money for, let's say, 6 months to 1 year, maybe 1.5 years. And this is the kind of investment tenure, segment, risk return profile which you are targeting when you are launching a market neutral kind of a product. But when you are targeting a non-market neutral kind of a product, this spectrum, the range of the spectrum then widens. Then you have to see from moderate risk to a more risk kind of a product are also available in the market. What is a moderate risk product? Something like your balance fund. So you don't want to invest in long-term debt. You take a bit MIP. MIP is some 75-25. Aggressive MIP. Then you have a conservative MIP. And those diversifications were earlier available, and, you know, today also available in the mutual fund segment. Similarly, these kind of products are available under the absolute return segment. Then you have some tactical options, which are aggressive in nature and which target a return which is, let's say, double digit or a higher double digit kind of a return, which are, you can say, equity minus kind of a risk profile. Now, depend upon who should look to invest into what kind of fund is your decision, right? So what are your diversification requirement, what kind of risk profile you have, what kind of liquidity you want, and what is your time horizon for investment will drive you to determine that whether you will look to invest into a market neutral product or you would look to invest into a non-market neutral product. And if market neutral and non-market neutral, then whether a long short and then multi-strategy fund, we'll get into that. Okay, now if you go back to this slide, I told you there was a problem, right? And then why suddenly the growth of AIF industry, we see some negative here. Although on the other hand, I am saying that long only fund are attractive, generating attractive returns. But it's still the industry AUM in terms of your hedge fund and overall industry AUM is going down. Why is it happening? Simple as that. The category 3 overall is meant to take leverage and to take exposure into derivatives. Now, derivative generate business income. That's for sure. And business income is always taxed at the highest level. Now, because this is a non-pass-through structure, the tax has to be paid at the fund level. And fund is a super rich entity because the fund income is always going to be more than 5 crores. But super rich tax slab in 2019 has been elevated from 35% to 42.7%. So what will happen? So we are talking about an industry which was generating 10 to 12% gross return. If you increase the tax from 35 to 42.7, it is broadly a 14% jump in the tax. Your net yield in the hand of investor will significantly come down if you don't change your strategy. Now, there are only two options left for you. One is either you change the strategy or you bring down the tax by changing the structure. Now, choice is yours. If you change the strategy, then the risk return horizon changes completely. You don't want to do that. So, it's like if I have to give you an example, it's like यू नो अभी सर व्हाइट रसगुल्ला नहीं है, आप ब्लैक वाला ले लीजिए, बट इट्स अ डिफरेंट प्रोडक्ट राइट, इट इज ऑल स्वीट डिश, इट इज स्टिल रसगुल्ला, बट दीज आर डिफरेंट टू डिफरेंट प्रोडक्ट्स. सो यू कैन चेंज द स्ट्रेटजी इफ यू हैव टू बी ट्रू टू लेवल. सो यू हैव टू ओनली चेंज द स्ट्रक्चर टू गेट द टैक्स एफिशिएंसी. इफ यू डोंट डू दैट योर नेट रिटर्न्स विल स्टैंड डाउन, एंड इफ दैट विल हैपन द प्रोडक्ट रिस्क रिवॉर्ड बिकेम लेस अट्रैक्टिव. And that's the reason that the HNIs who are very, they are very tax savvy. If their net yield will start dropping, they won't be interested in the product. Especially when they have an option to invest somewhere else, right? So if you are investing in, let's say for example, if you are investing today in a long short fund, what is your opportunity cost? I would have not invested in a long short fund, I would have invested in arbitrage mutual fund. Or I would have done FD because, or maybe a liquid fund, or maybe a short term income fund. If your net return are not consistently beating your opportunity cost by a significant margin, there is no point in taking risk. And suddenly what happens, the returns are beating it, but the tax hit on the trust structure have significantly dropped it down. And that's where the problem started. And then you have seen many funds changing their strategies, the way they invest, and all other things to try to align themselves towards this change. The investor expectation is what? It is liquidity, consistent return from a low risk market neutral kind of a product. Tax efficient, capital risk come ho, and post tax debt return plus is what they expect in hand. What is the problem and what is the solution? Problem is that trust section 42.7, LLP is at 35. I have not heard one. This company is at 25. SEBI allows you to construct the AIF as either as a trust or LLP, or maybe as a company. Now, trust is one of the most tried-tested structure in the Indian investment industry. People have seen it in mutual funds, and it is completely tried-tested from an income tax point of view, from an audit point of view, from a regulatory point of view, from a trust tech point of view, and it is the most preferred structure. Company has a different problem altogether, because if you make a company, then how will you treat the capital which you will raise from investor? When you give proceed to the investor, then the compliance of Companies Act is far more cumbersome, and there are fair chances of double taxation, and there are other more complexities too. LLP seems to be so we also face the same challenge. We say, what can we do? We cannot change the structure. What we would like to offer to the investors? So we decided to take the leap and take the first step and get into changing the structure for investment manager, not for the investors. And then we decided to come up with LLP. Now this is a new shift which you are, and as I believe personally that there will be more investment managers and AIF which will now, over a period of time after this LLP structure is settled, will be graduating from trust to LLP to enhance the return in hand of their investors. Look at the difference. One may ask a question, pehle kyun nahi kiya? LLP, you could have done LLP earlier as well. The point is, there was no need for such innovation. Because before 2019, the LLP taxation was also at 35 and the trust taxation was also at 35. The problem was not there only. When there was no problem, there was no need to try a new structure and take unnecessary risk in the market of then moving ahead and starting something which is not established in the market or doing something which is new in the market. You can blindly go with the trust structure. But then you have to. So what we did is, I hope we are the first one, and so far as I know, yes, we are the first LLP in the category 3 segment, in the long short absolute return segment, and our taxation is at 35. In nutshell, what it means is that Any fund manager who is running a strategy in the trust structure has to outperform me at least by 14% more to be at par with me in their yield. So if I am generating a 10% return in my fund, a fund manager of a trust structure fund would have to generate at least 11.5% to be at par with me in terms of net yield in the hand of investor. Now that's a significant outperformance in the segment wherein the margins are very less and you're talking about only 5-6% or 7% kind of a return in the hand of investor with at most stability of the capital. This is a huge gap. So we did that and we were the first one to launch an LLP structure in the industry. Now we'll focus. So, okay, sir, I think what we will do is we'll try and sort the questions till here before I get into my product, because you're talking about the hedge fund industry, and let's take some question in case if there are, to see if there are industry specific questions. Then I will get into the what we offer.
Sure, Amit, it has been very interesting discussion. Just give me a minute, I'm just trying to stop the slideshow. Right. So there have been actually, you know, very interesting series of questions. There have been, you know, a basic question asked by some of the people in the chat box saying that when PMS and mutual funds and other long only products are giving very good returns, why do I need to look at long short funds? Why do I need to, you know, even hear what are these, what is the space of long short funds?
Absolutely no need. Absolutely no need, and actually not needed if you are very sure they will continue to do that. If you think the market will continue to only generate positive return, if you are okay seeing your capital in red when market bleeds, if you are okay to invest for 20 years, more short term stability of capital, there is absolutely no need to do any conservative investment. So that's a call. And that's a diversification call, right? If you have 100 rupees today, you can take risk by 20 rupees, 30 rupees, 40 rupees, 50 rupees, or all 100 rupees. When I was young, I used to have 100 rupees, I used to take risk by 200 rupees. Now if you accumulate some wealth, if you have now 200 rupees or 500 rupees, I will not only, I will not take risk from 100 rupees, I take risk from 20 rupees. Because I want to generate, I want to keep my 450 safe. So, you know, it's very easy. Aapko karodpati se lakhpati koi bhi raato raat bana sakta hai, equity. So be rest assured about it. So it's all about your risk. If you are okay seeing it in red, perfectly fine. Market is doing fantastic, absolutely good. People have seen negative returns in the market. People have lost their capital. Few of them are still happy, then they have made their fantastic return. It's all up to you. But I think diversification still makes sense. And if you're diversifying, then what are you trying to do? You're trying to minimize your return or minimize your risk from equity to a lower level. When you're doing it to a lower level, you will take 35, when you take 35% kind of a debt, you get into balanced return category, balanced funds, right? That's what mutual fund also do. You say, boss, khali equity nahi karna, I want to lower down my risk profile. You say, sir, debt alag se kya loge, main aapko product bana ke deta. You take 65-35, right? So you get into balanced category. You don't put your brain in debt at all and sit quietly. If you are a retired guy, invest in balanced fund. Aur bhi kam chahiye, sir, MIP kar do. Even better. Magar agar MIP ka bhi risk nahi lena aapko, so then they say, sir, long-term debt, accrual fund. Accrual fund bhi nahi chahiye, short-term income. Wo bhi nahi chahiye, liquid fund, sir. So it purely depends upon, abhi liquid fund are the largest shareholder in the overall segment. Abhi, if we think that you know that the market will go up, are institutions also know that the market will go up, right? Why do they invest in liquid fund? They can only invest for 2 days in equity and generate 2%, 3% return. Why they invest for such a large amount in liquid fund to generate a 4% return annualized? because they don't want to take that risk. So it purely depends. I think the answer to your question is yes and no both. It purely depends upon your risk appetite.
Sure. So there is another interesting category, you know, of mutual funds, which was launched, I think, 3 years ago when debt taxation was, you know, kind of made little relatively unfavorable. Earlier, long-term, you know, the meaning of long-term used to be more than 1 year. And then, you know, it was made 3 years. And at that point of time, mutual industry had launched equity savings fund as a category. So equity saving mutual fund as a category, you know, I have seen a lot of advisors and a lot of people kind of trying to project that the long short fund categories is similar to this equity saving fund category. When equity saving mutual fund category offers you arbitrage, it offers you equity, it offers you debt, it offers you equity taxation. So it kind of tries to balance risk in a more superior way than a balanced mutual fund, balanced equity mutual fund. And at the same time, it also offers you taxation of equity and also offers you liquidity. Right, so you get everything. Why would you need to get into a absolute return fund? I know you. Yeah, please.
So simple answer. Very simple answer. Just take out the NAV of any equity saving fund where the market goes down by 10%, and see what kind of negative return they generate. You will get your answer. Or when the yield goes up, you'll get your answer. See, the point is. So what is the difference? So one may come up and say, what is the difference between a cycle, a bicycle, and a motorcycle? All have two wheels. They're different. So a long short fund is an absolute return based category. You said, don't look at the markets, whether they move up or down. I will give you stable return and most of the time positive in nature. And this is the maximum or this is the range I can generate return into. I'm not investing into equity. I'm not investing into debt. I am trying to be long and short in the market. I am trying to run my strategies in the market. There can be quant strategies. I can see there are some questions whether it's a quant fund, whether it's a long short fund, what are algo trading funds, what are quant funds, what are long short funds, what are market neutral funds. See, there are different strategies in market. Depends what your requirement is. So if you don't want to see capital in red, and you want a high liquidity, it's a no-brainer. You will go to liquid fund. You say, it's my working capital. I don't want to see it in red even for a day. That's what my requirement is. I may require this capital at any point in time. So I want a high liquidity. I don't care about the returns. If it is 3%, 4%, it's okay. Even if it is 2.5% post-tax, it's okay. But my prime of this requirement is safety of capital and liquidity. We'll say invest in liquid fund. So that's the requirement. Now, equity saving is specifically what you are talking about. See, there are parlance of things. When I say the absolute return category is almost for those investors who are debt kind of investor, that does not mean absolute return category is equal to debt category. Abhi, आप थोड़ा सा हंसोगे बट इट इज लाइक दैट अमिताभ बच्चन के पिक्चर का डायलॉग मुर्गा इतना बड़ा था बोले दूसरा हाथ नहीं लगाया राइट प्रॉब्लम इज आप रिलेटिव जब किसी चीज को करते हो अपॉर्चुनिटी कॉस्ट में आपको दिखाता हूं तो मैंने आपको बोला आपकी अपॉर्चुनिटी कॉस्ट क्या है आर्बिट्राज फंड अपॉर्चुनिटी कॉस्ट एफडी अपॉर्चुनिटी कॉस्ट कैश फॉर अपॉर्चुनिटी कॉस्ट बट कैश और आर्बिट्राज बराबर तो नहीं है एफडी और लिक्विड बराबर तो नहीं है सो व्हेन वी से अपॉर्चुनिटी कॉस्ट हम लोग बोलते हैं सीबीएल अपॉर्चुनिटी कॉस्ट बेसिकली वी आर ट्राइंग टू गिव यू दैट रेंज ऑफ रिटर्न कि इतने रिस्क में कितना मिलेगा आप जो रिस्क बोल रहे हो लिक्विडिटी चाहिए पॉजिटिव रिटर्न्स चाहिए तो आपको 10% नहीं मिल सकता अपसाइड में आप जिस रिक्वायरमेंट की बात कर रहे हो दैट रिक्वायरमेंट वी आर पॉसिबली टॉकिंग अबाउट 3-4% काइंड ऑफ टैक्स फ्री रिटर्न दैट इज द मैक्स यू कैन गेट इफ यू हैव दैट काइंड ऑफ रिक्वायरमेंट इफ यू हैव इफ यू देन एक्निंग काइंड ऑफ अ रिक्वायरमेंट तो आप अपनी रिलेटिविटी डेट और इक्विटी दोनों के साथ में बढ़ाते हो आर्बिट्राज फंड में नेगेटिव रिटर्न जनरेट करते हैं एंड आई होप यू हैव सीन दैट लास्ट ईयर अप्रैल इज अ क्लासिक एग्जांपल सो आर्ब फंड आल्सो कैन जनरेट नेगेटिव रिटर्न इट लिक्विड फंड हैज आल्सो जनरेटेड नेगेटिव रिटर्न फॉर दैट मैटर इफ यू कैन गो टू 2008 सितंबर एनएवी आई कैन एंड द एएमसी इज फुल एएमसी इज गॉन आउट फ्रॉम इंडियन मार्केट बिकॉज ऑफ लिक्विड फंड्स So that all is possible. Point is, what kind of risk you want to take? So it's a different category. If it says that don't look at the market, don't look at the debt yield, don't look at the equity, we will generate absolute return for you. But obviously, we are not competing with debt and we are not competing with equity. If you want absolute return, you want to feel safe, you want to be happy about what you are getting, but the max you can get is 6-7% post tax. You can't expect it beating duration funds if the yields are moving down. You can't expect it beating an equity fund. The other question may be, abhi wo 5 rupees lene ke liye, why to invest in a new category? Equity mein ek mahine mein lagaoge, 5 rupees milega. Rather, 5% to single IPO mein mil jata hai aajkal. So why to wait for 1 year for this? So that purely depends what your what kind of capital you are using and what kind of diversification you have in your mind.
Right. So when any investor gets into an absolute return fund category, right, so he has kind of, you know, made up his mind that, you know, with this particular pot of money, I am not wanting to take too much risk. I have my existing equity portfolio. At the same time, I do not want to put this pot of money, you know, in purely into fixed income, because even in fixed income, there are some sort of risks that I am taking, right? Whether it be a credit risk or it be a duration risk. But if I put my money to liquid funds or ultra short-term funds, you know, I sacrifice a lot in terms of my returns, because, you know, my I'm paying taxes. At the same time, you know, my post-tax returns is kind of very low, much lower than even inflation, right? So, and hence, you know, that investor thinks of getting into an absolute return fund category. So this point
or
is
maybe some, or maybe just to add something to it, need not necessarily that the investor is not investing in debt and want to get into long short. Point is, he might have invested in debt as well, but he want to diversify. See, debt has given you cushion against equity in terms of volatility, not yielding your return, but you want a cushion against debt as well. Now, equity is not a cushion against debt. The basic mistake which we do in making diversification or doing diversification of our portfolio is that when we say get out of equity, the only thing which we think is get into debt. Getting market is bad, get out of equity, the first thing which comes to your mind is get into debt. And when you say the debt is not favorable, what to do? I don't know what to do. Balance. Let us try something, a mix of this, right? So what I'm trying to tell you is that there is something else which is also available. If you are not comfortable with debt, the yields at are all time low. You think they're going to go down? I think possibly no. I mean, the answer is broadly no. You never know. But chances that they will move up. The market is at all time high. So chances of market coming down is higher than what it was earlier. I'm saying just chances. So equity is at all time high and yields are at all time low. So what do you think is attractive? Equities, chances of going down is high, and debt, interest rate moving up is high, obviously high. Then duration fund doubling is up. Equity may additional risk. So I'm just trying to tell you there is another category which is not linked to equity and debt, and we'll say, don't worry. If you are not sure and you want to diversify, there is a third category which can give you diversification both from equity and debt. That's what the category is all about.
Right. So now, you know, taking this example further as a particular example, assuming there is an investor who has a 10 crore portfolio, 5 crore is into long only products, put in mutual funds, portfolio management services, alternate investment funds, and, you know, that 50% portfolio is kind of like a firing gun these days. And because of which equity allocation has actually risen, and that, you know, overall, if out of 10 crores, 50% was in equity, and that 50% has all more, you know, it has kind of gone up to maybe 80%. And remaining, you know, 50% he had invested 5 crores into debt mutual funds, which is maybe growing at 5-6%. But investors doesn't mind that because his equity is kind of compensating. Now the problem comes when that investor is generating fresh 2 crores. Now where should he park? Should he, knowingly that yes, my equity, you know, has grown from 5 crores to almost 9 crores over the last 1 year, should I now invest my, you know, additional 2 crores into equity? Or should I, you know, invest into debt, which I know for last 1 year has been giving me only 5% return. And I know, you know, I do not want to take credit risk at this point of time. Neither I want to take a duration risk because I know interest rates are falling. Hence, absolute return fund category comes into that juncture. And we understand that. But now, please understand from, you know, this investor's perspective that this investor, if he has made up his mind, he has understood absolute return fund category. He wants to know that what can go wrong. If I enter into absolute return fund category, I have decided, you know, on my mind that I am okay to compromise on the potential returns, because it is okay. I know, you know, I'm not, you know, I am absolutely fine if I make returns maybe 300-400 basis points better than my debt mutual fund. I'm fine. But at the same time, I do not want to compromise risk, because that is what, you know, is the ultimate thing, you know, which was kind of pointing me to not put money to equity. Otherwise, I would have happily put money to equity. So, you know, when this investor tries to further deep dive the space of absolute return funds and talks to fund managers and talks to, you know, senior people like you, they are told that otherwise everything is fine, but there is only one risk, that there are few days, you know, over 1 year period or 2 year period when we see gap down opening. You know, it can happen overnight that market is opening next day at 10% down or 5% down. Anything can happen. And, you know, apart from those days, for all other days, absolute and fund is fine. But if anything such happens, then even we do not guarantee, then there is a possibility of you losing your capital. So at that point of time, you know, how do you address, if I ask you, you know, from your perspective as, you know, Dolat Capital's absolute and fund, first of all, please explain to me, you know, what is your understanding about this investor asking, and then how do you address this particular point?
Okay, so I would then first split it into tranches. One is what is your understanding upon what the investor wants, and number two is how we do. So I will only comment on what we do and will not comment on the other fund managers, because they might have different strategies. So I think it purely depends, sir, whether the investor want to take that 12 to 15 or whether he has made 8 to 10. He has got two more, and now what he wants to 8 to 10, he want to secure, two more he has, or he want to make 12 to 15. That will decide that whether he will come to long shot or whether the additional allocation will go where. Okay. If he is an intelligent investor, or maybe no, or a risk taking investor, from both the perspective, if he want to first ensure that wo jo 5 ka risk leke 8 banaya hai, wo 8 ko save karna hai kyunki bahut risk le liya hai market mein aur itna acha rally dekh liya hai. So he will say, let us first fix this 10, try not to take risk on this, or equity abhi bhi acha chal raha hai, to maybe I will still would like to participate in equity, but jo gain ban gaya usko hum realize karke save kar lete. So that can be one strategy. The other strategy can be equity chal raha hai sir, aap sara paisa equity mein kar do. That is, from 12 you want to make it 20. So that purely depends what the investor want. But broadly, all the family offices or sophisticated investor, when you have already made money in terms of percentage and a significant handsome percentage, if you have made in the market, you would first like to, you know, kind of bring it to safety. Ke return bacha lo, abhi mil gaya 20%, abhi mil gaya 30%. You have taken that risk. You are fortunate. You have got this kind of return. Your fund manager is fantastic who has generated this return. But now, if you will compromise again on those returns, so basically, what you have paid money for? So you have paid money to fund manager. You have taken risk equity market and you have again put in money to risk again, so at least secure the return and the capital. If you do that, then again the question comes, from equity to where? So from equity, earlier you had, now you have long shot as well, so you can possibly look to change it to debt, maybe short term, long term duration funds. You have all the funds plethora available in your traditional investment, or you can come to the long shot segment as well to secure the return what you have made in terms of your capital. So that's the answer of your question number one. Answer to your question number two is that how do we ensure that the gap up and gap down will not impact our fund? Very simply put, we don't take any directional calls in the market. When we don't take any directional calls, means we take all hedged, only hedged positions in the market. So let's say arbitrage. Arbitrage can be of two types. It can be a cash future arbitrage, it can be a basket arbitrage. Basket is basically Nifty constituent short or long, and then you have Nifty long or short. Or maybe a bank Nifty constituent long or short, and then bank long and short accordingly, in the same weightages. And you try and generate that tracking error only. So what will happen is that tracking error is the only decay if you are doing that arbitrage. And in the cash future arbitrage again, if you will get a hit of 20%, let's say it's a gap down of 20%. If you get a hit of cash, will aapne cash long kiya, future short kiya. That's the only way you can do arbitrage currently in the market. So agar aapka cash 20% down khula hai, to aapka future upar hoga. So you are basically neutral. Okay, so that's how one, in terms of your arbitrage, you basically try and save yourself there. And then you have options strategy, wherein you try and make the combination of put and call and future, all three put together, wherein all such extremities are then getting evened out. So अगर आपको आप future long हो और आपने put buy कर रखा है और आपका अगर market 20% नीचे खुलता है तो future में आपको नुकसान होगा, मगर put की value आपको उसको cover कर देगा. So this I'm just saying just for simplicity perspective. So there are strategies under the options wherein you can hedge all such positions, and then you can only play between that 5 to 10% movement and try and generate a stable return from there. The idea is not to give a significant return at all. I think I would possibly be one of those fund houses who will say, I am not here to give you significant return. Sorry, if you are thinking that I will give you 10% return, I am not the right guy, because that's not what I do. I generate a regular return. I generate a positive return. The idea is to first protect the capital. The idea is to keep the return always in green. But the maximum I can give you is 7-8. The most probable I'll give you is 6-7. You might end up at 5, you might end up at 4 as well, but it will be positive still. That's what the idea is, and that's how at least we manage. Our first focus is the safety of capital. So what we don't want to go back to investors saying there was a gap up, gap down, XYZ event, and you have lost your capital for a day. We don't do that. The worst thing which we can tell you, and which is our worst month, you say, sir, you have made a fantastic return of 0% for the month. So basically, no return for the month. This might happen in one of those extreme situations when there is no return for the month, but it's not negative. Idea is to do that. Try and not generate a negative return under any circumstance. If you do that, you take extra protection, you do many other strategies, try to hedge yourself. And everything has a cost. If you are running too safe, you don't want to get a negative return and you are putting cost to it, obviously your returns will come down. So hence I say that especially in my fund, the safety of capital is the primary thing what we want to do. We are happy underperforming. One of those managers who are very, very happy underperforming rather than coming back to investors saying we lost your capital. If I am saying that my gross return target is XYZ 10%, 12%, whatever it is, I am happy coming back to you and say, sir, I'm sorry, I've only generated 8%. But at least it is positive. Rather than saying that there was a gap up or gap down and you know we have kind of lost your money. We don't want to do that. So at least we are very, very sure. What we want to do is simply put, protect the capital at all point in time. The return will vary and will vary always. So that does not mean that you will get a stable return on month basis, because the market is not stable and I'm still protecting your capital. So that simply means that sometime you will generate 8% gross, sometime you will generate 12% gross, sometime you will generate 5% gross. There can be some extreme month you generate nothing. On an yearly basis, you will generate 6-7%. On a quarterly basis, you will generate 5-6%, 7% post-tax in your hand. That's what we are targeting. So it cannot be a straight line liquid fund kind of a category. If you really don't want to risk your capital anytime, if not even for a day, and you want a stable return always, liquid is the category. It is not a long shot fund. That's not your requirement. But if you are okay to invest for 5-6 months, want consistent return, and you want a return which is 6-7% kind, but you want capital safety, monthly liquidity is okay with you, you have money for 6-7-8 months, 1 year, then this is the category you should look for.
Right. So, we have covered the risk part. Now another aspect that comes to an investor's mind is that it is my hard-earned money, and I do not want to pay too much taxes on whatever returns I make, because I have sacrificed my money, and I have already paid taxes on that money. It is a tax-paid money, right? And then when I'm investing money in long-short funds, I'm definitely taking some risk. So, you know, whenever I take risk of equity, I am compensated by way of, you know, getting a very good and attractive taxation in terms of 10% as a long-term capital gain tax after 1 year. But in case of a long-short fund, you know, mostly fund managers and most funds say that this comes under super rich, and hence this particular category is taxed at 42.7%. So obviously, you know, this category is also taking some form of risk. So investor is exposing his capital to risk, and despite that, he's paying 42.7% tax. Please understand, in India, we know, you know, there are maybe 5 crore investors who are actually investing into equity, you know, products. And out of almost all of these investors, whether it be super rich, even they like to save tax.
Like to save tax. But the problem is, let me ask you this question, an arbitrary question. You have made money in equities. You don't want to risk it further. Okay. What will you do now? You will redeem it from equities. Obviously, you don't want to risk it further. Apne $100, and it's already became 300. You are very happy now. You have paid 10% tax. You got your money. Where do you got your money now? You have it in your bank account?
Yeah.
3% saving is also taxed at 42.7. Huh? Interest.
Right.
Okay, leave it. You have it in FD? FD interest is also taxed at 42.7. Okay, you have in short-term income fund? Unless you are holding it for 3 years and going for a double indexation, you are again paying 42.7% tax.
Yeah.
The point is, where else you will keep your money?
Yeah.
There is no way you can save that 42. The only way to save 42.7% tax is don't earn much. If you are in 15% tax bracket, you will not be subjected to 42.7. But if you are in 42.7% tax bracket, even if you keep your money in saving bank account, unless you are keeping it in cash. And if you are keeping it in cash, you are basically then losing out because of inflation, right? The time value of money also, then rather than paying, you are actually losing out on capital. So point is, everywhere else, it's a level playing field. It's not only with long short funds. Wherever you go, in debt segment and in derivative segment, which is non-equity segment, gold, again the same, you will end up paying 42.7%. There is no way you can run.
So let us talk about, you know, those investors. So particularly I myself, I don't pay 42.7% tax because I don't come into the super rich category. Mm-hmm. And there are a lot of investors who don't come into that category, but they are, you know, able to invest into, for example, an absolute return fund at the same time, right? So for them, you know, how is Daulat's absolute return fund, which offers LLP structure, different from any other fund? And why is it that you guys have an LLP structure and others do not have an LLP structure? This is the, you know, question which I want to ask you.
Okay. So one is that our taxation is at 35%. So we don't pay 42.7. So it is very good for those who are paying 42.7 because they have to only pay 35%. So for them, there is an arbitrage. For them who are in any case paying 35%, now I would believe that somebody investing 1 crore would have been paying 35% at least. He cannot be in a tax bracket of less than that. So those who are paying 35 anywhere else has also to pay 35 here. So that is at the same, at par. Okay. Now coming to your question number two. So I hope I address question number one. So for 42.7, we are offering 35%. So there is an arbitrage. They get a 14% more yield in their hand. Simple as that. For 35, they are at 35. So there is nothing to lose there. And why we only were able to do LLP and others are not, there is always somebody who come and take the. So we are the first one to do it, and there will be more to follow. If I am not wrong, there are a couple of guys who have already applied for it. One of them possibly would have got it as well. Going forward, you will see more and more people who will be interested and who want to come into this segment because of the taxation act.
So now, you know, I'm moving to last two questions.
Yeah.
Right. How would your strategy perform, and what can be expected from your strategy in following scenarios? A scenario like, say, March 2020.
How would my strategy perform in March 2020?
Yeah. In a scenario like March 2020.
You would have windfall gain. windfall gain in the strategy. I mean, windfall gain means something which you have never imagined. So any gap down and gap up which you have never imagined will give you gain which you have never expected from this strategy. If market tomorrow opens 20% down, I will break all my records of generating positive return.
And if market opens 10% up,
no problems, I will be in the range. See, what is the point when we manage investors' money who has already made money in equity, and now on the basis of diversification give it to him? What is his biggest fear? His biggest fear is ab girega to negative mat dena. Don't come back to me and saying equity is generated negative and I have also generated negative, because I need to generate money which is in line with equity market. So if I generate positive when the market goes down, and I generate 5 to 6% when the market post tax, I'm talking about everything post tax, I generate 5 to 6% when the market is normal. That is what he wants me to do. He wants me to generate normal return under the normal market circumstances, but the market goes down. Don't generate abnormal negative return. I'm saying I will not generate abnormal negative. I'll generate fantastic positive returns if the market moves down, if it is gap down situation. So March 2020 would have been a dream month for us if we would have been in existence by then. But going forward as well, I can say watch out for our performance, and on month, irrespective of market movement, you can expect us to be positive.
What is the best possible return that can be expected from you on an annual basis?
8%, not more than that.
8% is post-tax, post-expense.
Yeah. Not more than that.
Right.
On an average, it will be between 5 to 6% under normal circumstances. It will be 7 to 8 if the volatility increases. We want the market to be volatile, at least from our fund perspective. A stable market is not good for us. In terms of, we don't generate good returns in a stable market. When I say good, I mean towards 7-8%. When I say normal, it means 5 to 6% post tax with safety of capital.
So there is, you know, now I'm going to just, you know, speak out some of the, you know, questions that have come on the chat box. You kindly keep short answers. So losses in cash cannot be offset against gains in derivatives. How it is managed?
We don't. Everything in LLP is taxed at 35%. So it's a business income. So we will pay 35% on everything. So we don't need to manage it.
Right. How has investor perspective towards alternative investment funds changed post-COVID versus pre-COVID? Has COVID made your fund to take more conservative approach prior to COVID?
We unfortunately launched our fund in January this year only. So that is post COVID only. I don't know about prior COVID experience, but I don't think so. COVID has made any difference in terms of investor into long short. It might have changed some perspective in terms of diversification, how investor want to diversify their portfolio, but that is broadly towards the investment advisors. Who keep the risk, you know, different kind of risk as well, try and mitigate that. But apart from that, no specific comment from my side, because we started our fund in Jan this year.
So at 5% kind of expected returns that, you know, that you're trying to kind of claim as kind of, you know, bare minimum post-tax returns, an investor would rather put money into fixed deposit. That is another question which someone has asked.
Ah, fantastic. You put money in fixed deposit. Which fixed deposit is giving you 7%, out of which 42.7 or 35% you will pay, and you will end up a 5% tax free? If you are getting 5% tax free in fixed deposit, go ahead and do it. What is the issue?
What is the expense structure and how liquid is your fund?
So my fund has a monthly liquidity window. You can invest one time only in the in 1 month, and you can redeem one time in a month, which is the settlement day, last Thursday of the of every month. My expenses structure is obviously as per slab, depend upon what kind of commitment one has. But for a 1 crore investor, it is 1.2% fees. There is no entry. It is 1.25% fees, management fees. There is no entry, there is no exit, there is no performance fees currently. Let me add currently because that's the
So 1.25% as an annual fund management charge.
That's right.
No entry load, no exit load, and monthly liquidity.
That's right.
Right. I am an NRI investor. Why a person like me who wants to, if invests in AIF, invest in your AIF rather than, you know, a GIFT City AIF?
Ah, very good question. So number one, you have to wait for some time for the GIFT City AIF to be really operational, and if that is the case, I think you will be probably speaking to one of those who are market maker of GIFT City itself since inception. If there is a long shot fund which would possibly be most interested in GIFT City, you will be only considering my fund in that platform. So that's, I can tell you about the future. But yes, GIFT City is a very, very interesting opportunity which is coming up. No diversification norms, no 10% limit, no 2x leverage problem, smooth. The problem there is that you don't have a market there. And it will take some time, at least couple of years, I think so. We are already present there. We are the market makers of GIFT City as well. So we have our registered office. Everything else is set up. So it is still some time to for the GIFT City to challenge the Indian AIF industry at least.
Are there any operational issues in an LLP structure in terms of subscribers coming in and going out?
For the investment manager, yes. For the investor, no. There are more compliances to be done from an investment manager perspective, not from the investor's perspective. So investor will be treated almost operationally, almost as what they would have been possibly treated in the trust structure. And no further documentation which is needed. But from an investment manager perspective, yes, it's a compliance service structure, which has nothing to, no impact on the investors at least.
So, from the presentation that you had mentioned, where you had highlighted absolute return funds have two subcategories. One is market neutral and one is not market neutral. So you come under not market neutral, right?
No, I am a market neutral fund.
Okay, perfect. Right.
So I don't take any exposure, any not even a percent single exposure in the market. So B market open 20% down, 20% up, 100% down, 100% up, not going to impact my return. Right.
So for our audience, you know, market neutral means, you know, having kind of a negligible position as a carry position overnight when you are, you know, building your portfolio. And in absolute return funds category, there are two types of funds. One, those funds which follow market neutral category, wherein which they have equivalent amount of shorts and equal amount of longs, and hence net position is kind of negligible in terms of equity. And there are some funds that carry some long only positions, you know, and at the same time parallel you also create using derivatives longs and shorts, and hence they have both, you know, market neutral as well as long only positions. So Daulat's absolute return fund category, when it is kind of claiming, you know, a lower post-tax, post-expense return of say 5 to 8% as a territory, is absolutely market neutral fund. And hence, you know, that is why he's very confidently conveying that if at all we have a gap down opening, you know, the fund will not be impacted. So for those, you know, people in the audience who have asked questions regarding how fund would have performed in a month like March 2020, fund would not have delivered negative returns, where Nifty had fallen by, you know, 23%. And there were many, many, I would say, even long short funds that have fallen by 3% to maybe 10%. And there were particular days when, you know, markets were actually very bad. So all that would have been protected, you know, if one was invested with this particular category, because it's the market neutral category. One thing
so I would yeah. I just want to add one thing.
Sure.
Now, would have been, could have been, is always saying that you claims I don't know, right? I was not there in 2020. So we can wait for that 20% fall and see it like. So that's not a problem with us. So if you want to wait for that 20% fall and see my positive return, I'm okay. I'm happy waiting for the day.
Sure. So I was actually going to sum up by saying that, you know, if there are any risks that, you know, you would like to highlight, because this comes out, you know, as a product which has very, very high levels of controls in terms of risk management, right, and has high liquidity, also provides, you know, I would say the most efficient taxation for this category, right, at the cost of, you know, one kind of compromising high returns. But when one gets, you know, all these three factors, then a linear and kind of a foreseeable return of 5 to 8% makes this an attractive fund. But if we have missed any risks, or you want to highlight any risks, you are most welcome to do that. That is what I was, you know, coming at.
Please. So the biggest risk which we carry is onboarding an investor who doesn't understand the fund. If you don't understand the fund, don't invest in the fund. You know, I very clearly said, there can be circumstances, exceptional circumstances, wherein there can be 2-3 months of performance which is hardly 4-5%, maybe 1-2%, maybe a 0% performance. And then somebody coming back to boss, you said 5% at least minimum guaranteed post tax. That's not what we are saying. We are saying on a linear basis, with a 95% probability, there are expectation that under normal circumstances of market, you will get 5-6% post-tax if you will stay invested for at least a quarter and more. Okay. If you don't do and you come on a monthly basis, you want to invest in a month and then redeem like your arbitrage fund, blah, blah, blah. First of all, I don't want the money because that's not what the fund is for. Although there are no exits, but we have kept no exit for the learned investors, that they understand that they're only parking the money which they don't need in 1 month. The last thing we want to say to the investor is, I will take some exit load because I don't want you to redeem. No, I understand you are sophisticated enough to understand that this is a 3-month, 6-month product and should invest for that period. But in case of emergency, you want your money and nobody to stop. But in case of emergency, don't look at the returns. So my point is, 5%, 6% on an average means, does not mean it's a liquid fund. 5%, 6%, 45 degree, it will go. No, it is not the case. Sometime it will generate 8% annualized for a month. Sometime it will generate 7%. Sometime it will generate 12%, 13%, 5%, 4%, maybe 0% for them. That might so happen. But two things are for sure. We don't want to generate a negative return. And we want to generate a return which is at least 6-7% for my investor in their hand. If everything goes fantastic, you might end up with 8% return, maybe 8-8.5% on a higher side. If things are not going good, on an average, you will end up to 5-6% kind of return. But that's what we can offer. Because, you know, if you...
all of us understand there is no, you know, guarantee or no assurance of returns. But obviously, it is an endeavor and you have, you know, indicatively conveyed your point very well. One last aspect that, you know, I would like to cover, you know, and I want you to answer this. There have been, you know, many, I would say, super rich investors who have been approached by, you know, Zerodha's True Beacon product. And Zerodha's True Beacon.
I will not comment on a particular product.
So I am not wanting to comment on a particular product. And, you know, we have great regards, you know, for every product. I'm only wanting you to kind of, you know, because that is a more popular product and many investors try to relate long short fund category with that product because this category is new to all these investors. So how is your product different from, you know, the product offering of Zerodha? Or you can say, please answer this question by trying to explain that how is True Beacon product, you know, kind of one of the products amongst various types of products in this long short fund category.
So you, sir, you are my eyes and ear to all the investors. I will explain everything to you on a personal call, but I cannot comment on comparing my product with any other product at least on a public forum, because see, these are different products. Every product have their own uniqueness, their own risk, their own appetite. So let me, this is kind of, so I will explain, we can discuss that in person, but I would like to reserve my comments of comparing any product with mine on a public call.
Sure. So thank
Hiruda
you.
Hiruda is a fantastic company. So, I would say that, see, every single product which is available in the market, be it any player, be it the largest player of the industry and be it the smallest player of the industry, are unique in the nature, because this is a new segment. This is an upcoming segment. You will find fantastic investment managers and fantastic returns, mind-blowing strategies and very good performance from this. There are 800 AIF registered. There are many in category 3 segment. So everyone is unique and they have their own advantages. They will have their own positives. You just have to look for the negatives. I am not here to count my, tell you the positives. I'm here to tell you where I can go wrong. I've told you I can generate a 0% return. Absolutely. You can ask the other party, what is the negative you can generate? End of the story, you will understand that what kind of risk you are getting into.
Right. So to, all our, the entire audience and everybody who have asked questions from us, warm thanks for participating in this session. And I would just sum up by saying that obviously, all products have their importance, and particularly, we have to understand this absolute and fund category requires one to deep dive the risk part, which is what Amit tried to convey, that compare products on the basis of, which product is taking, how much risk. Because as we rightly kind of concluded, while I gave that example of why one would want to enter into this particular category, investor is only and only wanting to enter into this category to keep, one's risk low, and at the same time, one is trying to maximize one's return. So keeping risk as the foremost aspect, how to kind of get best possible return or optimal return is where, this particular category is all about. And that is where, Daulat's long short fund fits very well. And unlike Daulat, there are a lot of other products which may not be fitting exactly the way, this fund fits. And that is what differentiates this product from all other products. Without naming any other product, this is what Amit is trying to convey. Thank you so much.
I'm also saying that there can be other products as well, which are not available today, which might be available tomorrow, who might come in the same domain. The point I think I want to make here is that it is not about whether you invest in my product or not. The most important thing is whether you understand what you are investing into or not. That's most important, because if you understand what you are investing into, then you can choose the best fund manager. That's a different story. But if you don't understand what you are getting into, then you are inviting trouble, whether it is Daulat or whether it is some other investment manager. So it's important. It's a sophisticated investment category. It's for sophisticated investors. You should understand which kind of product, what to expect, what are the risks associated, what is the maximum negative I can see. Ask such question to understand which product you are getting.
Right. On a casual note, Amit, I would just tell you that, at the beginning of this session, I had done a poll that what is my understanding of long short funds, the category, and have I ever invested or have I ever advised on this product? 75% of people had said no. I do not know, after this session, whether we have been able to convert those 75% people, with some knowledge. I'm sure we have done our effort, but the point is, people are absolutely today, I can tell you, closed-minded to knowing more about such products. Why? Because people are colored by the very high returns that equities have given. And I can see that, from the chat box, people have been mostly asking these questions that when equities have been giving me so high returns, why should I even think about a category which gives me 5 to 8% as a post-tax and post-expense return? And I'm sure, when we see those times where equity markets remain kind of range-bound or equity markets are negative, these investors and these advisors will try and deep dive this space, and that is where they will understand. And that is exactly the point which is done by a good advisor in terms of asset allocation. And that is, that is our intent in terms of educating the entire ecosystem in deep diving the space and taking right and informed investment decisions. And we have been doing that very well. And thank you so much, Amit, for joining us for this session and enlightening this space. Even if we have been able to add 1% more knowledge to the space of long short funds, I think we have been winner. And with this, I would like to again thanks everyone for joining us. Thank you so much.
Pleasure is all mine. Thanks a lot. Thanks all for joining us. Thank you, sir.
Pleasure.